Hello everyone, I'm here today to talk to you about the digestive system. It feels very fitting to be giving you this lecture in my kitchen, of all places. We're going to get to talk a little bit about nutrition, but mostly we're going to be focused on the physiology of the different organs involved in the digestive system. So starting right off, just the fact of the matter is humans are heterotrophic, we're not able to photosynthesize, and so that means that we have to take in organic molecules from other things. So we're dependent on organic molecules, and I just want to have you stop and think for a minute, why is that the case? Why do we need organic molecules? All right, it seems like kind of a simple question, but actually, why do we need organic molecules? So for one thing, just building blocks, right? We need these things to allow us to build up tissues and replace things that need replacing. But this is also where we get all of our energy to power the different things that are going on in our cells. So the way that we make ATP is from these organic molecules that we obtain from eating food. So food is essential, right? The digestive system is essential in order to allow all of the other systems to do their jobs. So organic molecules, in order for us to be able to utilize organic molecules, there are two key things that have to happen. Usually organic molecules exist as polymers. Usually they're kind of long chains in the food that we eat. And so the first step is just to break up those chains, break them down into smaller pieces. And we have, in our digestive system, we have enzymes that are very specialized to do just that. So remember back when we were talking about chemistry in the beginning of the semester, we said that monomers, the small subunits, they can be attached together through dehydration reactions. And then the opposite of that is if we split them apart, if we take a polymer and if we split off monomer units from it, what we would be doing is carrying out a hydrolysis reaction, using water to split bonds. And so in our digestive system, we have enzymes that are very good at carrying out hydrolysis reactions for specific types of molecules. So we're going to be looking at carbohydrates, we're going to be looking at proteins, and we're going to be looking at lipids. We're not so much going to focus on nucleic acids, though we are eating them all the time too. We're going to primarily focus on carbs, proteins, and lipids as we go. So first step, digestion, right? Just breaking those molecules down through hydrolysis reactions. Second step then is to absorb those small molecules, the monomers. We need to absorb them into the bloodstream in order for our cells to actually have access to them. So digestion followed by absorption, those are the key things that the digestive system needs to do for us. So the digestive system, it does a lot of this by means of a tract that goes all the way through the body, starting with the mouth, ending with the anus. There is essentially, it's a tube that goes down the middle of the body. And this has a few different names. It's called the digestive tract. It's also called the gastrointestinal tract, or GI tract for short. And it's also called the alimentary tract, or alimentary canal. So it's got a few different names, but in any case, it's just referring to this, the set of organs that goes through the middle of the body and helps us with digestion and absorption. So the funny thing, sort of unusual thing about this system, the gastrointestinal tract is considered to be outside of the body. Okay, so it's a tube that goes right through you. However, the contents of that tube is still considered to be outside the body. These aren't things that are inside of our tissues, all right? They are kept in that lumen that goes through the middle of the body. And so these materials are outside, actually. And one of the things that this tract does is it helps us to make a separation. Things that are usable by the body, those are going to get transported inside of our tissues, then they'll be considered inside the body. But substances that are not usable, such as cellulose, we don't have a way to utilize cellulose. So undigestible things like that, they're just going to pass through the tube, they'll leave the body through the anus, and they never actually get taken into the body. So, as the food moves along through this GI tract, it passes through different organs, and each organ is specialized to do a particular task. So these organs, they're sort of arranged in a chain. We'll be walking through this series of organs in this chapter, and first thing, just there has to be a way to keep the food moving along from one organ to the next. So we're going to break it down. What are the functions of the digestive system? Certainly digestion and absorption, those are key functions, but there are some other functions that have to be there in order for this whole system to work. So number one right here, just keep the food moving along. Being able to move food through this tract and have it move in a one-way direction, right? We don't want food backing up, going the wrong way. We want it to continue moving in one way only. A lot of that is accomplished by peristalsis, which are muscular waves accomplished by smooth muscle. So peristalsis, this is something that happens automatically. It's under the control of the autonomic nervous system. However, before that, we have to initiate something. We have to initiate swallowing in the mouth, and that's under voluntary control. We'll see a little bit more of that later. In any case, one function is to allow us to move food through the tract. Number two, secretion is extremely important in this system. So we have to be able to secrete, for one, just digestive enzymes and hydrochloric acid in the stomach, but perhaps even equally important to that is secreting mucus. Mucus is something that helps to protect the lining of this system, the digestive system, and it provides some lubrication so that the food can slide along as those muscular waves push it through the tract. We're also secreting some other things like water, bicarbonate. We'll see that a little bit later on. And then hormones, actually. The digestive system secretes hormones that regulate digestion. They also help to regulate hunger. We'll see that a little bit later on, too, when we get to the stomach. Okay, digestion and absorption. Of course, those are key functions. We already kind of touched on those. With regards to absorption, something that you might not know, but you're going to learn in this chapter, is that absorption is kind of discriminatory. It depends on what the molecule is in terms of how it's absorbed. So carbohydrates and proteins, those will get absorbed directly into the blood from the digestive tract. But fats get treated a little bit differently. Lipids actually get absorbed into the lymph instead of the blood. So slightly different means of absorption there for the different types of molecules. Another key function is storage. There just has to be a place to keep things until we're ready to get rid of them. So the digestive system provides temporary storage. And this is for undigested food, right? The things that we don't want to bring into the body, into the tissues. We just need to be able to have a place to keep them. Digestive system allows us to do that. And then finally, last but not least, there is a very strong immune presence in the digestive system. Number one thing that contributes to immunity is just the fact that there are tight junctions between cells. So this helps to prevent a lot of pathogens from being able to enter into the body from the digestive tract. However, if things do make it through, if things manage to enter into our tissues, there are a lot of immune cells that are present there just kind of waiting, just in case foreign pathogens make it into the tissues. So there's a tight relationship between the immune system and the digestive system right there at the GI tract. Major components of the digestive system include, we're going to start at the mouth. The mouth is the oral cavity. What we have is a series of organs that are all connected to each other, sort of arranged in a chain. So from the mouth, where the food goes next is the pharynx, that's kind of in the throat area. Then the esophagus leads to the stomach, which leads to the intestines, and then finally the anus is where undigested materials would leave the body. In total, this gastrointestinal tract, composed of all these organs, in total it's about 30 feet long. That would be in a living person. In a cadaver, it would actually be significantly longer, and that's because of the relaxation of muscles in a cadaver. But in a living person, it's estimated to be about 30 feet long, so that's a really long tube. It has to be in order to give us time to do what needs to be done to the food, digest it down and absorb what we need from it. In addition to these organs that are arranged in series with each other, We also have some additional organs that are very important for the digestive system to work correctly. These are called accessory organs. They include things like the teeth, right? Teeth are very important just for starting the digestion of food, helping us break it down into smaller pieces mechanically. The tongue is extremely important for allowing you to swallow your food. Salivary glands, of course. Saliva includes the first digestive enzyme. Salivary amylase is the enzyme that starts the digestion of carbohydrates, complex carbohydrates like starch. Salivary amylase breaks starch down into a disaccharide, and then digestion continues later on in the small intestine. Anyway, these are accessory organs. They're not necessarily in the tract, the GI tract, but they're doing extremely important jobs. The liver, the gallbladder, and the pancreas. We'll have some information about each of those coming up later on. What is the color coding I have going on here? I've got some of these highlighted in blue. Well, not highlighted, but the font is in blue. This is meant to tie back into when we talked about the autonomic nervous system. We said that there are these two branches. There's the sympathetic division and the parasympathetic division. And the organs that are in blue here, these are organs that are under control of the parasympathetic division. The vagus nerve innervates all of these organs, and when the parasympathetic division is active, it is stimulating these organs. So remember, the sympathetic division was the fight or flight, responsible for the fight or flight response, and then parasympathetic is more the rest and digest. Well, how do you digest? These organs have to be activated in order for that to happen. So the parasympathetic division particularly activates these organs that are indicated in blue. Throughout the gastrointestinal tract, so this tube that goes through the body, throughout this tract, the wall that's lining this tract has four key layers. These layers are also called tunics. A tunic is like a cloak, something that you might wear. The gastrointestinal tract has four layers that it wears in order to allow it to accomplish what it needs to. The innermost layer, which let me just point up to this picture here. So the inside canal, this would be called the lumen of the intestine. This is where the food would slide along through. The lining of this tube, the innermost lining, is called the mucosa. This is, let me come down to this blow up here, the mucosa. This is the surface that is most directly exposed to food, and it does, kind of like its name implies, the mucosa does secrete mucus. So this provides the mucus lining for the GI tract. This is also, of course, the first place where food needs to cross over, food molecules that have been broken down. This is a layer that they have to pass through in order to be absorbed. Once they pass through the mucosa, they end up in the submucosa. The submucosa is where we have a lot of capillaries, a lot of vasculature. We've got some lymph, so lacteals, we'll talk about these later, but this is where the lymph travels into, is in this area as well. So the submucosa, this is where a lot of the absorption happens, the taking up of nutrients into one of those two fluids, either blood or lymph. Let's see, the next layer is muscle. So muscularis, this is made of smooth muscle. This is what allows peristalsis, and also there's another word here, segmentation. This is another type of muscular wave that happens in order to move food along. In any case, that muscle layer is essential for the movement of food down the GI tract. And then finally, the serosa. Serosa would be the outermost layer. You can see it right here on this picture. The serosa just is providing a protective layer on the other side. So it's kind of binding the GI tract from the outside and providing protection on that side.